Long ago, Greek scholars created a list of the seven wonders of the world, but that list only included the incredible monuments and other marvelous structures they knew about, which were all located in Greece and other surrounding countries. These scholars were not aware of the many wonders in the other parts of the world, especially in Africa, one of the largest continents on Earth. In ancient times, some Africans lived in powerful kingdoms where they built some amazing wonders. One kingdom built giant temples carved into the side of a mountain. Another kingdom built an enormous stone city surrounded by a thick stone wall. Another group built hundreds of stone pyramids as tombs for their kings and queens. What other ancient wonders does Africa hold? Some are hidden in vast deserts, along ancient trade routes, and in glittering cities. Well, you are about to gain extra knowledge of the seven wonders of ancient Africa. But before we do that, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and turn on the notification bell to receive the latest videos as they drop. You can also leave your comments, give this video a thumbs up, and share it with your friends. After Muslim conquest altered Christian pilgrimages to Jerusalem in the 1180s, King Lalibela of Ethiopia decided to construct for a holy land 11 medieval monolithic churches that were carved out of a rock. He called it New Jerusalem. The 11 underground churches, located in a mountainous region in the heart of Ethiopia, some 645 kilometers from Addis Ababa, are carved both inside and outside entirely by hand and chisel. The roof of the churches is at ground level and it plunges down to 40 feet. The fact that these churches were constructed primarily by hand shows the level of creative and artistic finesse exhibited by Africans who occupied this region in the 12th and 13th centuries. Today, Lalibela is a high place of Ethiopian Christianity, a place of pilgrimage and devotion. The rock-hewn churches of Lalibela are still preserved in their natural settings. The association of the rock-hewn churches and the traditional vernacular circular churches in the surrounding area still demonstrates evidence of the ancient village layout. The original function of the site as a pilgrimage place still persists and provides some proof of the continuity of social practices. The intangible heritages associated with church practices are still preserved. Adorned with tall, slender pyramids, the wealthy Nile city of Meroe was the seat of power of Kush, an ancient Nubian kingdom and rival to Egypt, which exuded power and gold. Rising high in the sky in the modern-day nation of Sudan is a plethora of pyramids. They mark the site of the ancient city Meroe, a UNESCO World Heritage Site. The center of a powerful civilization, Meroe served as the capital city of Kush, whose robust culture thrived for centuries. Their grand architecture and works of art left a lasting testament to the greatness of the Nubian kings and queens. Located in the desert sands near the Nile in modern Sudan, the ancient culture of Nubia played a decisive role in shaping Egypt from the 8th century BC, serving as the kingdom's 25th dynasty in the late period. After the Nubian pharaohs lost power, they moved south from Egypt to form the Kingdom of Kush, which thrived in splendid isolation as the rest of Egypt suffered through repeated invasions from Assyrians, Persians, and Greeks. Because of Meroe's distance, the Kushites were able to retain their independence, developing their own vibrant hybrid of Egyptian culture and religion until well into the 4th century AD. With access to mines and minerals, the Meroites were expert gold workers. They built temples, palaces, and royal baths in their capital. Perhaps their grandest achievements are the more than 200 pyramids built at the necropolis at Meroe, giving Sudan more pyramids than all of Egypt. Tall, slender, graceful, these monuments bear witness to the lasting splendor that was Kush. Sankore Mosque and University is the oldest continuously operating institution of higher education in sub-Saharan Africa. It is believed that the mosque and university were erected in the 12th century by Berbers who settled in the Timbuktu region of modern-day Mali. Mansa Musa I, ruler of the Mali Empire from 1312 to 1337, made several improvements to the mosque after his pilgrimage to Mecca in 1324. He staffed it with scholars in various fields and helped it gain more visibility within the Islamic world. The mosque and university underwent more changes under Askia Daoud, the ruler of the Shungar Empire from 1549 to 1583. Askia Daoud grew the mosque and university to 180 facilities and 25,000 students, a remarkable feat considering that the Timbuktu population was only 100,000 at the time. Most of the university's professors were educated in Islamic universities in Mecca and Fez in present-day Morocco, Tunis in present-day Tunisia, and Cairo, Egypt. They followed the Maliki school of Islamic philosophy and were members of the Qadiri Sufi order. After the Moroccan invasion of Shungar in 1591, the Sankore Mosque and University were stripped off of most of its scholars and many of its texts were destroyed. The university still exists today, however, serving primarily as a place of Quranic studies for young children. The walls of the Benin Kingdom in present-day Nigeria covered 6,500 square kilometers and extended for some 16,000 kilometers, connecting more than 500 settlement boundaries. They were all dug by the Edo people around the year 1055. In all, the walls, known as the Iya in the Edo language, were reportedly 4 times longer than the Great Wall of China and consumed 100 times more material than the Great Pyramid of Giza. They took an estimated 150 million hours of digging to construct and are perhaps the largest single archaeological phenomenon on Earth. As lines of defense, the walls were heavily guarded around the clock. They stopped invaders as they could be seen whilst trying to get through and were killed or captured by the Benin soldiers guarding the gates and walls. The ramparts, which were steep banks of earth, stopped invaders climbing over them as they could be buried in a sand avalanche. The sand on their weapons could disable them. The high walls made it difficult for attackers and invaders to climb over. Invaders trying to climb the walls were good targets for the Benin soldiers' spears and poisoned arrows. The outer walls, which were very high, provided a thick shield around the city. As a matter of fact, the walls kept out European slavers who were in search of slaves to transport to the Caribbean and the Americas on their slave ships across the Atlantic Ocean. One of Africa's ancient architectural marvels, the Great Walls of Benin were destroyed by the British in 1897. This shocking act destroyed more than 1,000 years of Benin history and some of the earliest evidence of rich African civilizations. Abu Simbel is an ancient temple complex, originally cut into a solid rock cliff in southern Egypt and located at the second cataract of the Nile River. This monument was built by Pharaoh Ramses II in the 13th century BC as a gesture of love for his wife Nefertiti. The Abu Simbel temples were carved out of a mountain on the west bank of the Nile. There are two: the Colossal Temple of Ramses, which was dedicated to the Egyptian gods Ra-Horatki, Amun, Ptah, and the deified Pharaoh himself. The smaller Temple of Nefertiti was dedicated to Hathor, the cow-headed Egyptian goddess of love. In the doorway to the main temple are 4 statues of Ramses, each more than 20 meters high, accompanied by the smaller statues of the Queen Mother and Nefertiti. Above the doorway stands a figure of the falcon-headed sun god Ra-Horatki. Inside, his statues of Ramses hold up the roof of the Apostle Hall. The reliefs on the wall show the pharaoh victorious in various battles. In the next hall, Ramses and Nefertiti are shown in the front of the gods and solar barks that will carry them to the underworld. The innermost chamber is the sacred sanctuary, where the gods, including Ramses, sit on their thrones. Every February and October 22nd at sunrise, light penetrates the temple and illuminates the faces of these figures. At some point, the temples were abandoned and in the period afterward were covered with sand, the Great Colossi gradually disappearing into the desert. In 1813, a Swiss traveler and geographer, Johann Ludwig Burckhardt, noted the existence of the site, and then in 1817, an Italian explorer named Giovanni Belzoni uncovered the buried entrance to the Great Temple. Construction of a reservoir for the Aswan High Dam in the mid-1960s threatened the Abu Simbel temples, so an international team reassembled them on higher ground. These reconstruction efforts, which required that the entire mountains be cut into blocks, moved and reconstructed, took more than 4 years and cost $40 million. The Swahili Coast, a 1,800-mile stretch of Kenya and Tanzanian coastline, has been the site of cultural and commercial exchanges between East Africa and the outside world, particularly the Middle East, Asia, and Europe, since at least the 2nd century AD. In the following centuries, trade in goods from the African interior, such as gold, ivory, and slaves, stimulated the development of market towns such as Mogadishu, Shanga, Kiwa, and Mombasa. By the 9th century AD, Africans, Arabs, and Persians who lived and traded on the coast had developed a lingua franca, Swahili or Kiswahili, a language based on the Bantu language Sabaki that uses Arab and Persian loanwords. They had also developed the distinctive Swahili culture, characterized by the almost universal practice of Islam, as well as by Arabic and Asian-influenced arts and architectural styles. The arrival of the Portuguese explorer Vasco da Gama in 1498 signaled a new era of foreign rule on the Swahili coast. By this time, Mombasa was the dominant Swahili power, so control over the city meant control over the coastal region. Portugal, seeking to monopolize trade through the Indian Ocean trade, built Fort Jesus in Mombasa and also set up a customs house on Pate Island. The Portuguese were finally pushed out of power on the Swahili coast in 1698 by combined forces from Oman and Pate, though the Portuguese remained in Mozambique until the late 20th century. Following the scramble for Africa of the late 19th century, during which the European powers divided East Africa among themselves, they began to control trade in the interior, bypassing the Swahili middlemen. Today, Dar es Salaam and Mombasa are the biggest port cities on the Swahili coast. Both have been significantly transformed by industrial development as well as the migration of upcountry Africans. Smaller Swahili towns, however, such as Pate in Kenya, retain much of their traditional culture. For these towns, beachfront tourism has become an important economic component. Great Zimbabwe is the most famous of a large group of stone-walled enclosures on the Zimbabwean plateau. The modern Zimbabwe nation took its name from the major cultural monuments. In the language of the Shona people of eastern Zimbabwe, the word Zimbabwe means stone building. The highest point of the site is a fortress that has a commanding view of the surrounding grasslands and can only be approached through the series of narrow defiles. According to scholars, the structure was erected by the Shona people over the course of about 400 years, beginning in the early 11th century. At its height in the 13th century, Great Zimbabwe's capital was home to as many as 18,000 people. Subsistence to support such population concentrations remained crucial, and it is likely that cattle and agricultural surplus played a highly visible role in the maintenance of power. The collapse of the Great Zimbabwe occupation is dated to the late 15th century, when most of the site was abandoned. Reasons posited for Great Zimbabwe's collapse have included the possible exhaustion of local gold, arable land or water resources, and the disruption of the Indian Ocean trading sphere by the Portuguese. Majestic successor states such as Kami, located further in the interior, soon sprang up, but none ever achieved the power of Great Zimbabwe, which remained an important religious shrine until the 19th century. If you enjoyed the video, don't hesitate to like and share it with your friends. Would you like to know more about great kings in ancient Africa? Check that out in the next video. You can also subscribe to our channel to receive the latest videos as they drop.